All right, I got a hypothetical for you.
A hypothetical. Let's go.
A hypothetical.
Hypothetical.
Not an original. This is taken from Oni Plays, but I was interested in your reading of it.
And my response to
it. And your response, which is, what is the least someone would have to do for you to saw their head off with a circular saw? The least they'd have to do.
That's a really morbid question. That's honestly, it's gruesome.
Mm-hmm.
It's gruesome. Gosh.
Don't try to evade, dude. Well, what is it?
I don't know.
The answer? Because I think that we could all agree that there is something. Like, there is a scale of things that are very egregious that would cause you to break into the point of doing it.
You're describing not only killing somebody.
Yes, but doing it with malicious...
Doing it with a malicious, sadism way. Because I say would kill somebody if they threatened my family.
Yeah.
Right? As in, not saying they threatened as in I'm going to kill your family, but were in the process of attempting to kill my family. Yes, I would kill them.
Mm-hmm.
But saw their head off with a circular saw.
Yeah.
Turn myself into a Jason Voorhees-esque character.
Mm-hmm.
Because of that? No. Because primarily it's impractical. Because in order to saw somebody's head off with a circular saw.
This is not about the semantics here.
No. It is about the semantics because if I'm trying to do it, it means that I will have had to have made the decision to most likely incapacitate, kidnap,
and then
circular saw
true.
The person. And so it's a lot of steps. I don't know because I don't know how I would act in a situation in which I would have to be particularly vengeful.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's the thing is it's really hard to entirely gauge it because, you know, you don't really know how you're going to act in that kind of a like high stress kind of situation where
situation, then it means I'm probably going to like maybe kill the person, but not in a manner like that.
Yeah. Well,
I don't know. What about you?
I asked my wife the question and she said, if somebody cut your head off with a circular saw, or my child, then I might do it, right? Like I might get mad enough.
Yeah, but then you have to have the kind of streak for poetic justice.
I know.
Well, say to yourself, you did this to me. Bygones.
Well, so like, what I would say is like, apply that to just whatever the method might have been that was gruesome that was used to kill me, right?
Okay.
So like, say instead of it was a circular saw, it was like an ice pick or something like that, or like a screw. You know, it was all crazy.
Yeah.
It was torturous. It was bad. That level of thing.
Ice picks aren't tortures.
Well, I mean, it depends on how you use them. You know.
Yeah, you say that about, okay, whatever.
You know what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
If it's to that degree, that's the level where you break through and you're like, I will cut that person's off with a circular saw. Somebody's head off with a circular saw, right?
Yeah, I don't think I have an answer to this question.
Yeah. It's a tough one.
Yeah, I keep creating caveats in my head and I'm like, okay, sure. If something gruesome and terrible happened to somebody I love, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't. I'm not John Wick.
I know.
I'm not sitting there writing up plans. You know, if I have to kill somebody out of sort of some sort of petty revenge,
well, how about this?
I'd probably just like spaz out about it and like bring a gun to wherever they are and then like make a fool of myself or something. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like I'm not gonna.
How about this? Let's change it up.
Maybe my employer and my wife and my child and everybody are all dead. And I'm left like destitute on the street, but I have some sort of.
And you have nothing to lose.
I have access to an industrial sector of some sort, like a sawmill. And I'm in there and I'm like drawing up plans and I'm going through trash cans, finding all my materials that I need. And then I wait for them to walk out of a fancy dinner
You become Jigsaw.
I become Jigsaw.
Yeah.
I think. Yeah. While I'm rifling through the trash, I find some sort of ventriloquist dummy. I paint its face up to look like a clown, make a motorized trike for it.
There you go. What more do you need?
Have you seen those videos? I haven't watched one, but there's videos where this guy does economic analysis.
of how much money it
would actually take to do a jigsaw trap. I don't think it'd be as elegant as that.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't think, if I wanted to teach somebody a lesson, because Jigsaw's whole thing is he teaches people lessons.
Yeah.
It's like, you shouldn't be so greedy. You know, it's like, why don't you just make them watch A Christmas Carol? I'm sure they'd get the same lesson off of that.
That is an insane take, but okay.
Yeah, you shouldn't be so greedy, or like stop touching your coworkers or whatever, right? And then he creates an elaborate thing where something sucks their eyeballs out or whatever,
yeah.
Which I think is how something that happens in the most recent movie. So it's like, I'm not sitting here. I don't have that kind of streak. I'm not saying a rain will come and wash away these dirty streets. You know, I don't have a vigilante.
That's you. You're that mind. Rain. No. Yeah. Okay. How about this? Let's shake it up a little bit.
Okay. Okay.
You What's walk the... into a room.
Okay.
And it's all set up for you already. Right. The person that okay. you have the animosity towards.
It's got their head underneath a circular saw.
Under a circular
but
saw.
But that means I'm the plaything of a jigsaw. That means that's some sort of serial killer.
And then the screen pops up, turns on, the CVT screen turns on, and it's like, in life, you would not cut a man's head off with a circular saw. Here, you must, or else.
What?
I haven't thought that far ahead. I was assuming you were going to do it.
Okay. I'm going to get hot oil dunked on me or something. You're still peeking. I'm going to turn you down.
Okay. Well, so there is one more potential wrinkle here. And unfortunately, I can't say that I have a good answer for this either. I mean, I would say it comes down to opportunity. And if it's relatively easy to do and there are not other avenues in order to punish this individual, then maybe
you're saying that if you enter a combat arena and the doors have that like red web that goes over it and Devil May Cry and there's like a glowing circular saw in the distance you would go
that
over
I could
and
use for
circular saw.
An area kill
I don't know, man. It's like,
well, okay, what about this instead of
I'm just gonna say, unlike most Oni's plays hypotheticals, this isn't a very good one.
Yeah, okay. Well, how about this aspect of it?
Okay.
What if instead of a circular
what
saw...
What if I'm walking and I trip and there's a guy whose head is under the circular
listen,
saw...
Listen, this is against the spirit of the question.
Okay.
It's about what could drive you to do the thing.
Well, I was making fun of you.
Well, I know.
Creating more and more of this hypothetical, so I would actually
do this. How about this? Instead of a circular saw, it's a handsaw.
All right.
We're talking.
What would it take me to handsaw? The exact same.
The exact same?
Yeah, although it'd be easier to bring somewhere.
It's a lot more intense.
Yeah.
It's a lot more bloody.
Maybe they had been bitten by some sort of extraterrestrial monster that was going to turn their head into a monster if I didn't cut their head off, maybe. Mm.
Wow.
Look, there's easier ways to skin cats.
What if somebody skinned your cat, dude? Would that be it?
Then I'd say, thank God.
I don't have to deal with this.
Stop having to deal with this stupid-ass cat. No. Oh, my gosh. So we turned her into an outdoor cat now that we have a baby.
Yeah.
Because I can't baby an animal when I have an actual baby, mm-hmm. right? And so she's in and out, and she comes in every night, or she comes in multiple times during the day. She usually stays out during the night. We feed her. She usually uses, it makes some things a lot easier for us. Her life expectancy is now a quarter of what it used to be. although Hillsdale, the farmers were so adamant about preventing any sort of predatory infestation that there's no like coyotes or anything in city limits. So we don't have anything to worry about that. But she, now that it's winter, is so mad, so unbelievably mad, because first off, she still likes to go outside at night. And so when I wake up and I go out and I open the door for her, she is mad instantly. Mm-hmm. She has a million energy because she can't run around inside like she can outside. And so she spends all day just like pouting and yelling at us, like literally just sitting there and yelling at me, just meow at me. And then I go check her food. She has food. And of course, she's like a cat now who refuses to eat her food unless we go over and like touch it.
Stir it around with your finger.
And then now she's learned this new thing, which is where water comes from that's pure. Mm-hmm. And that's the faucet.
Pure water.
So she'll sit there and she'll meow at me for 20 minutes until I turn the faucet on so that she can lick water out of the faucet. It's like having a child with no benefits. It's so annoying. And then she's mean now. She's mean because she's an outdoor cat now. So it's like,
well, sometimes they go through the teenage years. They're gonna be unappreciative. They're gonna be aggressive.
I was under the impression she'd already gone through that phase, but potentially not. I hate that thing. I hate that thing so much. Sometimes I'll go out of my way to be affectionate towards it, in spite. I'll be like, this is what you get.
My love and affection.
My love and affection.
In life, you mistreated your cat.
Yeah.
Here, you must be mistreated by a cat.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't mistreat my cat, okay? I don't hit her or leave her without food or anything along those lines. But I sometimes feel like I should. I feel tempted to.
Yeah, yeah. How? What would she have to do for you to cut its head off with a circular saw?
Gosh, that's not much. Probably knock over a boiling pot of water onto my feet or something.
That would be enough.
Yeah, that would be enough. I wouldn't cut it off with a circular saw. I would just throw her outside and never let her back in. That's all I would do.
That was not the question, but
yeah.
You know,
or I would drive like 20 miles and just put her in another town or something.
Sounds like you really thought about this.
Well, there have been multiple moments where she hasn't come back for like a day or two, where we kind of enter this Halicon like, man, imagine if she just doesn't come back. Ooh. And then she always does.
Oh, goodness.
She always does.
Guys, welcome to freaking Monomaniacs podcast.
Yeah, a little bit more of a psychopathic episode
opening
so far.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Which, I mean, hey, you know, this is our psychopath arc. We're here.
Yeah, what's the least that the government would have to do for you to take terroristic action against it? How about that?
We shouldn't talk about that on the podcast.
I don't know, man. It's just weird that you came in and you're asking me to try and gauge my own ability for bloodshed.
Listen.
I've grown up in weak times and has made a weak man. All right? I'm not capable. I mean, who knows what I would be able to do, you know? And I am somewhat trained for these sort of things, but I don't think that I would go out of my way to murder another human being. I just don't think I would.
Listen, these are just the questions that people are interested in hearing about. I've done the analytics.
That's true.
I've done the research.
Our audience is saying, you know, one of the reasons why we've kind of been on the fence about the show lately is that we're just like, we want you to explore the darker sides of yourselves.
The darker sides of your own
self. You guys are putting on too much of a mask. Mm-hmm. You guys are showing yourselves as these happy-go-lucky twins, you know, who've got all these really inane problems that don't matter, mm-hmm. right? What about what's really going on? What
exactly.
happens when things go dark? Mm-hmm. And I hope that maybe we can explore that further in this episode. Welcome to the Origins of a Serial Killer special of Monomaniacs.
The true crime section of this podcast.
We've prepared dozens of hypotheticals mm-hmm. Equivalent to that that we're going to kind of go through right now. Mm-hmm.
But before that, if you guys like the show, make sure to like and subscribe and freaking comment on this freaking thing. Dude.
Exactly. You make sure that even if you want to argue about our hypothetical, you know, in the comments, actually, you should answer the question. Mm-hmm. What is the least that you would take for you to cut some set off with a circular saw? I'd be happy to hear your answers to that question. But even if you want to call me all the names that I already call myself as I'm drifting off to sleep every night, then feel free because... Yeah. A broken record, you know,
is right twice a day.
It's right twice a day. It's what they say.
That's what I've heard.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
So do you want another hypothetical? Do you want another?
Do you have one? You seem prepared.
I've got some hypotheticals rolling.
We have some more hypotheticals. Okay. Yeah, what do we got?
Okay. So we got ourselves a trolley problem.
Okay.
We got ourselves a trolley problem. Okay.
Can it be something other than a trolley? Is that what it is?
It is a trolley.
Oh,
it is a trolley-esque problem. Well, no, it's literally a trolley problem. Okay. So you've got two tracks.
Can it be like a tractor? Or instead of a trolley, how about it's one of those things that two guys have to push up and down? That like you're only in Looney Tunes?
Yes, but they're two very fat men who are very bad about the fact that they have to do this.
Okay.
Factor that in into your your decision making. You know, it's not going to go as fast as it could. And there's a lot of venom in the people who are doing it.
Okay,
right?
They're
they really
sweaty.
Did not sign up for
I can
this.
See that.
A bunch of, both of them shirtless.
They're wearing overalls, though, as mm-hmm. as was the time.
Yeah, as was popular at the time. And so they're going, they're huffing and puffing, and you they're not going to stop, dude.
Okay.
Like that, the momentum on those two men is, it's an immovable object.
I couldn't offer them anything in barter?
No. I mean, maybe you could offer to take their place, but it would be the same outcome. Okay. It would still roll.
Okay.
Right. The track is continuing to go, and it will run over two people. It's going to run over two people, guaranteed. That's what's going to happen if it keeps going straight.
Mm-hmm.
If you switch it over, it will also hit two people, but it will do a sick loop-de-loop flip before it hits those two people, mm-hmm. right? So it's the same bad outcome, but it looks a lot cooler. Okay, it's
but I have
sweet.
Direct physical action.
Yeah, yeah. So you have direct physical action to change whether or not it's going to look cool when those two people die, Right.
It's not the same two people, though.
No, they're not the same two people.
See, if it was the same two people, then yes, you hit the flip.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's inoperable.
But let's say for the sake of, let's not, you know, they are society-wise, contribution-wise, morally, they are basically equivalent. Right?
Yeah, it's not my position to make that judgment anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, so
would you
do it for
the sick flip?
For the sick flip.
Yeah. Like this thing is going to, it's going to do two loop-de-loops. The guys are going to do Superman off of it as it goes over a gap.
Okay.
And then lands before running into those two people.
Hits two people.
Yeah.
Is this something I can film?
Yeah, let's say you can. Are you trying to say, okay, well, so that's kind of psychotic to say that, but. Are you trying to say, like...
And the audience doesn't need to know how it ends.
Yeah. you just want to capture the sick flip?
Yeah.
For your own...
Put it on YouTube, monetize it. Mm-hmm. That's my own content, baby.
Yeah.
No, actually, you'd probably lower the moral value of doing the action.
Yeah, I think
I don't pull the switch, by the way. I don't pull the switch. Okay. That's my... The moral action would have to be not pull the switch, mm-hmm. I think. In that circumstance.
Because you would be making a decision to make it happen.
I would be making a decision between two people. And, you know, even though I would be having them equal in my brain, I think that would be being actively a participant in mm-hmm. the death of these people. My inaction would cause me to be a participant as well. But I think that an evil acted upon and an evil not prevented, I think, are not
How about
necessarily
this?
Equal.
Is there a degree of awesome flip, right? Like freaking sick ass.
This is Reddit ass stuff that you're dropping right now.
Is there something that is to the level?
No,
that you would do it
if they're the same guy again. If the track is just going to detour and do a sick flip, sure, why not? But I'm not going to be an active participant in the murder of a person.
Mm. No fun at all.
I'm already the active participant of murder of people by purchasing an iPhone. You know what I mean?
Don't need more blood on my hands.
I don't need more blood on my hands, mm-hmm. right? So, I don't know.
I will say, I think I agree with you, though, if it was the same person, as you mentioned, like, regardless, it's going to hit the same two people, but you can make it do a sick flip, I would totally flip that switch.
Yeah, and I'm sure that in panic, I would assume I was helping.
Yeah.
I'd be like, oh, this will stop it. But then also, it goes, it's actually dope as hell.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Terrible, but also dope as hell.
Yeah.
Perfect.
So, I don't know.
Yeah.
That's my answer.
That's your answer.
Yeah.
Well, okay, we're going to go to the board.
Oh,
psychotic. You're psychotic.
Okay.
Still.
I'm still psychotic. Mm-hmm. Well, let's see if we can work my way on the scale. Let's see if
to go further.
Who wants to be a serial killer? Dylan, I'm going to play.
Okay. Will do. All right. Your next question. Ding.
We asked 100 serial killers.
If you were a serial killer,
okay.
What would your identifiable pattern be between your victims?
What?
There's always a pattern. There's always a particular thing. What would be your calling card specific thing you would do? Would it be the type of victim? Would it be the method? What would you do?
You're getting like weird about this. Because what if I say, okay,
listen, this is all hypothetical.
What if I gave you a type of victim right now? What would you read into that? What am I going to say?
Well, I would say...
What, you want me to say a race?
Bike guys.
A gender?
I would say bike guys is who I would kill. I would kill guys that are bike guys. Guys that wear tight bike clothing and bike around and occupy the road.
They'd be easy to slash.
Exactly. Because
they're not wearing baggy clothing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, you could get at them very easily in that respect. You know, they're out for some reason in the middle of nowhere driving around on backwoods highways while I'm trying to get to work.
Yeah, except they always drive in twos for that exact reason.
It's... Not those that I've seen, you know.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, there's not enough of a community around here for people to be like, have bike groups, you know. So this is actually the perfect opportunity in this area, you know.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. And also, it's just kind of funny, I guess. I don't know.
I think my pattern would be, white males between the age of 20. And 29, who I'm directly related to genetically, as in, I don't know, potentially my twin brothers, just my twin brothers. That's my pattern.
That's your pattern.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Goodness. I thought you were going to say white males between the ages of 23 and 29 that wear Monsters ball caps, pajama pants.
Grinch body guys.
Yeah, yeah.
I actually brought out Grinch body the other day during Thanksgiving dinner when somebody was asking about dudes who just drink Monster Energy all day and et cetera, or some people who drink soda constantly.
Explain what
skinny.
Grinch body is for those that don't know.
Grinch body, which is not an original Shadrachism, is somebody, you know how like you'll see a guy and he'll be skinny as a rail, but you know for a fact he drinks like 4 or 5 energy drinks a day. He's nothing but Kraft mac and cheese, all that stuff. And you're like, how the heck does this guy stay so skinny? / like, how's he alive? Well, it's debatable whether or not he is, but...
Alive, you mean?
Yeah.
Is that truly living?
Most of these guys have what I call Grinch body. Now, there's like outliers, like motocross guys who are somehow ripped.
Yeah.
Despite all this, and I don't get it. Riding a motorcycle is not that physically intensive, but here, sound off in the comments if you call me a bitch or something saying motocross isn't intensive.
Yeah, you're freaking trying to diminish the valor of
I'm sure your abs
guys.
Get a real workout when you're 50 feet in the air.
doing Supermans on your trolley,
doing
dude.
Supermans on your trolley, but those guys are somehow still skinny, and like you could see them sometimes where they have arms that are tiny, just like tiny arms. Usually they have a big old belly. Mm-hmm. They look like the Grinch. That's why I call them Grinch bodies. Mm. Not an original, but yes, they have Grinch bodies. And I think that, I don't know, there's less of those guys as you get older because they end up just getting fat. But, you know, usually they're a contractor of some sort, you know, or they're always like saying they're training to be an electrician, but they're not really, you know, that's sort of kind of in my mind.
They're apprenticing
somewhere. That's the Grinch body. It's the Grinch body lifestyle.
The Grinch lifestyle.
The Grinch lifestyle. They're like really bad at modern warfare, but they play all the time. I don't know. That's sort of my mind of what the archetypal Grinch body. Let's just say, yeah, sure, why not? I'll change my answer from my twin brothers to guys who have Grinch bodies. Because I'm sure that they've like, I don't know, said something racist at some point.
True.
Or maybe hit their girlfriend. I don't know. So that's what I'm doing. And I'm taking all the Kyles out of the world.
In life, you drink nothing but energy drinks. Now you must not drown in a pool of energy drink.
It's Monster Zero.
To do so, you have to say something nice about another race.
Yeah.
No, I can't. I can't.
Yeah, the whole time he's having his Confederate flag tattoo lasered off.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, actually, here's a hypothetical for you.
Uh-oh.
Okay. Pick a random vice.
A random vice?
Or a bad thing someone could do. A sin. Pick a sin.
Okay. I'm going to say disrespecting the Sabbath.
You're disrespecting the Sabbath. Okay, yeah, yeah. So now you're Jigsaw. And somebody's been disrespecting the Sabbath.
Oh, no.
And you want to teach him a lesson.
Okay.
What kind of insidious trap
would I set up for this person?
Yeah, so that they're Sabbath respecting. So they would die so knowing? I don't know. Yeah,
so that they'd die. Is my goal to, and this is a hotly contested sort of point.
Contested.
Point amongst the Saw community, right? Which is sometimes these traps are like unbeatable, but ostensibly the goal is to reform the individual, right?
Yeah.
So is my goal.
But usually they have to do something super painful in order to not be killed.
So is my.
Like have each one of their fingers broken.
Is my goal to reform this individual, or is it to make them realize.
It's whatever Jigsaw's goal was.
In this instance?
Yeah.
All right. Okay. So this is what I would do. Yeah. I would have them wake up. Tied to a bed.
Yeah.
Okay. Wake up tied to a bed. Very comfy, actually. Right. We're talking the nicest sheets from Bull and Branch. We're talking freaking those My Pillows, dude.
Yeah.
You got the My Pillows.
And then Mike Lindell's like, I'm Mike Lindell.
In life, you disrespected the Sabbath.
Sort of actually sounds like something Mike Lindell would do.
Exactly. All right. So they wake up in this very nice, comfy bed. Okay. In life, right. You would sleep through the Sabbath, right? You know, you wouldn't.
I mean, unless there's a church service involved, it's actually not wrong to sleep.
Well, no, I know it's important to rest on the Sabbath, right?
Yeah,
it's important to rest on the Sabbath. We know this, all right? Let's not argue the semantics of this. How about this? Let's talk about let's say it's I'm already imposing my morals onto an individual.
Okay.
So I'm going to say
it's
from
Christian Sabbath. Go to church.
Yeah, Christian Sabbath. Okay. Go to church, worship God, don't work, and, you know, be in self-reflection for a lot of the day.
Okay.
Right? So they're in the bed, right? Tied to the bed. Okay. In order to get out of the bed, right, they have to pull their arms, right, to untie something, right? But to pull their arms, they have to pull it through some razor wire of some sort. The idea would be is I make it especially hard to get up, right? You know, and, you know, in order for them to survive, they have to go through the hardest wake up and get out of bed they possibly could, right? And
what's slowly killing them?
Let's say that there is a acid... There's a tank of gas, right?
Okay.
That's slowly filling up the room.
Okay.
And I also have a lighter that's on a timer. And once the timer goes off, it's going to ignite the gas and the whole thing's going to burn up into a big furnace situation. That's what I do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then you do that and then you're like, how is there two people in the chamber? they walk away.
Yeah, completely
alive.
Completely do it. Yeah, as it burns, I look through my little window and I see two figures in the flames.
Yes, yes.
When there was only one footprint in the
hypodermic needles.
Yeah, it was me carrying it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So that's what I would do.
Okay. All right.
How about you? How about you, brother?
Well, you have to pick a vice because I already know.
Okay. How about
sin?
Okay. How about
it's an odd November/December content to be recording.
Exactly. Yes. This is very holiday focused.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is very holiday focused. Let's say
this year I'm giving thanks for my enormous fortune I can use to torture evildoers.
Goodness. All right. This is, so we're going to say it's just a sin, just a core sin.
Hey, just
any vice?
Thing.
How about this? How
somebody
about this?
Doing something
this person
wrong.
Is parking in handicapped parking spots.
Okay.
When they're not, they should not. Or they're pulling up to load their car in a Walmart or Costco and it's holding up everybody else, even though it's a no park, no load zone.
Okay. So I'm going to go with handicapped parking.
Okay.
Okay. I think this one's easy. This one's easy. Mm-hmm. So. Let's say they, you know, lights come on, they wake up.
Put me there. I'm there. What am
there.
I doing?
You look down, your legs are strapped to a table.
Okay.
Okay, you're all of you is strapped to a table and right. laying there.
Mm-hmm.
And then as you wake up, a machine drops a sledgehammer down, right? And it's pointed between your legs.
Mm-hmm.
Right, sort of like a misery situation.
Okay, so it's gonna like break my legs.
Yes, so, you know, Jigsaw comes on, he's like, is this thing on? And he says, in life, you parked in handicapped spots, preventing like maybe three guys ever from getting to the handicapped spot. But those three guys were veterans and they had to hobble to get their milk. So, you know,
dastardly,
seriously dastardly. Those people lost their legs in a foreign country, you know, and here you are making them walk an extra block. So you're laying down and at this point, a machine lowers a tube over your face and vacuum seals it.
Okay.
Vacuum seals it.
My face is vacuum sealed in a tube.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. And you have a button in your hand. Okay. And he says, above this tube is a piranha tank.
Okay.
In 3 minutes, I'm going to open the piranha tank. And look, I assumed that you had prevented more handicapped people from getting into the store than you had. I was going to say you have to press the button for every time you had prevented a handicapped person, but I'm just going to say, how about 10 times that many times? Okay, so 30 times you press the button, and every time you press the button, the sledgehammer is going to swing and hobble you.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So that you will need
a handicap
pass. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But you have to force yourself to be smashed with this hammer mm-hmm. 30 times.
How about make it simple? Every time you've parked in a handicap spot, you have to press the button.
Then that would be like too high. Maybe like 250. That would be way too high.
I mean, at this point, you know, the toughest thing would be pressing it that many times in 3 minutes.
Yes, that's true. It'd be really hard just to even press it that many times.
I was imagining it was going to be every time you press the button, one piranha falls down, and you got to, you know, press it that many times, you know, watch out.
I don't know. Also, what would probably happen is, I mean, the piranhas would probably not perform the way you would want them to. I mean, every time
the
evil
water
villain
doesn't come with it, it's just one piranha slaps you in the face.
That'd be funny, actually. Just jumping around, biting in the air. I've always thought it was funny when villains or, you know, that when they have animals as a part of their plans, because animals, I mean, even if you don't feed an alligator or whatever, or piranhas, it's not like they're going to just instantly attack when you so desire. I mean, if you have sharks, you have to chum the water because otherwise, unless they think you're a seal.
I mean, what I would do is I would put them in a seal costume and throw them to the sharks.
I suppose you're wondering why you're in a seal costume, Mr. Bond. Well, after
I really understand exactly why, really.
After
it's pretty self-explanatory.
Last week's disastrous attempt to feed you to my great whites, I've made some changes. Carl informed me that they all don't really eat people.
Who's Carl?
His assistant.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Dr. Nosebleed.
And his assistant, Carl.
Yeah, his thing is that he's got a short leg. He doesn't, you know, he just hobbles. And he doesn't have a nosebleed. I don't know why they call him that.
Oh, okay.
It's because his voice is really high. Causes people's noses to bleed.
Okay, yeah. So
anyway.
I mean, I feel like you could chub the water with your nose blood then in that instance. You wouldn't have to worry about the steel costume. I don't know. I think there's just too many steps here. That's all I'm saying.
So the big question I have for you is, how, you know, actually, this is a good hypothetical. What is the highest level of pain that you would endure in a jigsaw-esque trap to prevent your doom? Because I was watching one where I was like, I could do that. And it was a trailer. It was for the new Saw movie. It's a vacuum tubes over someone's eyes, and it's trying to suck your eyes out and kill you that way somehow. I don't know how that kills you. Probably just blood or whatever. One hand, he has a button, and he has to press the button. And every time he presses the button, it breaks one of his fingers. And once he breaks all like the fingers on one hand, or maybe it's all fingers. I don't remember if it's all of his fingers, or all the fingers on one hand. But then it stops sucking his eyeballs out. And he's like sitting there going, button. And he goes, ah. And then he keeps sucking. And then he goes, button. Ah. I would just be like, I would hit the button so many times that I would make myself pass out from the shock of it.
Yeah, yeah.
And then
call it good. Yeah, yeah. Well, I think that's something that people have often talked about with jigsaw stuff.
Yeah.
It's like those incremental pain ones would be so much easier if you just like ripped the Band-Aid off and did it all at once.
Yeah, well, I bet you some of them are incremental pain where you don't have as much control over them. But yeah, no, I'd just be like, yeah, I'm just going to press the button 10 times. You know, it's going to be the worst thing in the entire world, but it's going to be better than being dead.
Well,
and there's worse things than a broken finger too. I that's what
you
was
can
strange.
Say that about a lot of things.
I know. It's just a strange, it was like strange, but it was like a broken bone, like that hurts, but it's not like,
what was the crime this individual committed?
I have no idea. Looking at too much stuff.
In life, you looked at things.
Yeah, I don't know what having your eyes sucked out is supposed to like indicate. You ate too much live fish.
That is a hellish thing to do.
I know.
Yeah. Those things feel so much pain.
You went to China and had that thing where they pour boiling oil on the
octopus.
On the octopus and it moves. That's animal cruelty.
Yes. For that, I will suck your eyes out.
It'd be really funny if he had the tubes and then just on the other end of it is just jigsaw with his mouth on a tube.
Runs out of breath.
Yeah. And it's just like thump. It's like, oh, this is the back of my throat.
Jigsaw dies choking on the eyeball.
Yeah. Falls and over. The guy's just in the trap. He's like, hello. I've actually always wondered that one too. What happens if Jigsaw like trips and falls on one of his own traps? Has somebody done this bit? I feel like that'd be a good horror short story.
Where somebody accidentally falls into their own
Somebody falls into their own contraption, which that'd be kind of, I don't know, it'd be kind of funny. But I mean, that happens all the time in real life for like shotgun traps and stuff. But, which I know how to make one.
You should not say that on podcast.
No, I downloaded the Anarchist Cookbook, so I know how to do all the bad stuff.
Dude.
What?
Dude, this is going to be brought up with the FBI freaking kicks your door.
No, I mean, it's like, it's legal. You can run it at your local library.
Okay.
But regardless. Imagine if you're there and you're like stuck in one of them's like a merry-go-round. Oh, what if this would be even worse. What if it's one of those ones where you've got like three people in on the trap and you have to like make a decision.
On who to kill. Yeah.
Right? Or it's like everybody can vote to kill one person, but if nobody votes for you or something like that. Right?
Yeah.
This is what would be the funniest thing. You're all sitting there and it's like, all right, my pretties or whatever.
Whatever he says. My pretties.
All right, my pretties. make your vote now on who you want to kill. And if it's unanimous, as in if two people vote for one person, wouldn't be unanimous. But if a majority of people vote for one person, they die.
Everybody has to vote for a different person.
No, everybody has to vote, but only like one person. Okay. Stop asking questions. It was clear enough. It was clear enough in my head. So if you have three people,
yeah.
Right, now we're designing another trap. But if you have three people and the thing is, it's like, okay, two of the people have to vote for one person to die.
Okay.
It's anonymous,
mm-hmm.
right? And if two people vote for one person, they die. And if nobody votes for anybody, they all die.
Mm-hmm.
Or if everybody votes for themselves, they all die.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So you have to like either vote for one person together, and if everybody
what I'm imagining
if
is
everybody
you said that as Jigsaw, and what if all of you vote for it was clearer when I wrote it down, would you vote for him, but then also that person in life,
and if you do a write-in candidate that's called a Trump and we reset the suit. You guys ever play a trick-taking game before? All it is if two people vote for somebody, they die, and if they can't reach a consensus, then, I don't know, like, one of those, like, hand-grab things that you use to extend your hands, but bigger, is, like, eating your feet.
I don't know. No!
So that's happening. And
but it's one of those little T-Rex ones.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so it's but it's got razor blades on it.
Okay,
so,
okay.
So
yeah,
it hurts. So that's happening. And so Jigsaw's like, make your vote, pretties. And then they all vote for like the wrong person. He goes, eh, eh. And it's like, and they go, ah, make your vote. Make another vote, pretty. It's like, it should be me. Kill me. You know, et cetera. And they're all doing this.
Yeah.
And then it's like, Boo, it's like, oh, well, it seems you voted for Brian. All right. Guys, help. I've fallen. I've broken my neck. Help. You know, all this, like, sitting there, and it's like, what? You just hear him die over the intercom, and they're like, are just
stuck
in the trap.
There. Yeah.
And it's just stopped, and everything's quiet. And all the industrial music that was playing a second ago just isn't playing. And then Brian is like, you guys voted to kill me.
What the hell, guys?
What the hell, guys? And they're just sitting there. They have to just, you know, the game of escape is just them figuring out how to get out of the damn trap.
Because
you sort of, there's like this odd social contract that exists between Jigsaw and his victims.
Mm-hmm. His pretties.
His pretties or whatever they are. You sort of, or we don't even have to say Jigsaw. This could be any sort of trap building serial killer. We could call him, I don't know, Jenga.
The Trapinator.
The Trapinator.
Yeah.
And Jenga is like, oh, you know, when you're entering into a trap built by such a serial killer, there's this social contract that exists where you're under the impression he's going to honor his part of the deal. where he's like, in life, you ate too many grapes at the grocery store without paying for them. Because of that, I'm going to pluck your eyeballs out and you have to eat your own eyeballs or this will rip you in half.
In life, you ate too many grapes. And here, you must reach into this bowl of eyeballs and grab the key. You've been blindfolded. Which bowl of eyeballs is it in? Oh, that's the one with brains in it.
You start freaking out. He's like, no, chill.
It's okay. They're just grapes.
They're just grapes. But if I was sitting there like, okay, so you want me to eat my own eyeballs or you're going to feed me to this rat or something, right?
He's just sitting there with a bib on and two little forks.
Yeah. You're going to feed me to this rat who's obviously too excited. But you're like, you're going to make me eat my own eyeballs. Okay, well, how do I know that if I eat my own eyeballs, you're going to let me walk out of here? Jigsaw? Jenga?
Well, I mean, that's a point of contention in the series because there's a period of time where it's not Jigsaw who's doing it, it's his copycat, and he always kills no matter what.
Right? Oh.
So it's just.
And then Jigsaw is like, he doesn't understand. He doesn't do it for the love of the game.
Exactly.
I mean, honestly.
I think the phrase is, I don't murder people, which is suspect.
Yeah. I feel like I would have to, I have to say, whoa, time out.
The universal timeout.
You're going to time out in any scenario. People won't tell you this.
Yeah. If you hold your hands up in a T formation and go time out, everybody has to stop doing what they're doing.
Yeah, no matter what it is.
I was in an armed robbery once on the receiving end.
It's funny, I was literally going to make that same joke.
Time out, guys.
And as long as you reset after the timeout to a perfect equilibrium, then everything's cool. That's fair. That's playground rules. Yeah. But if I go time out, okay, I need some assurances here.
Yeah.
All right. That you're going to let me go if I, do the dumb thing that
he says, all right, pinky promise. And a little puppet hand pops up out of a chute, and you can pinky promise with the puppet hand.
I think I'd take that pinky promise. And then when I eat in my own eyeballs, and he's like, wrong guess, I was crossing my fingers.
No,
then the rat eats me.
Goodness, the rat. I just imagine this little cartoon rat
licking his chops.
Yeah, his name's Jeremy. He's excited. He's ready to go.
He's blinking, and he's like, your stomach is like turns into a whole ham. He's like,
goodness. Do you have any idea what time how we're doing?
No. You're supposed to keep track of that.
I know, dude. I gotta go check.
Okay, so imagine, wait, what is it? 45. Okay, so imagine, here's a good one. Imagine this episode should be called Shad and Duel Gets Sick and Twisted. Imagine, all right.
This is our edgiest episode of all time.
Imagine you're sitting there and then like a guy cuts you off in traffic.
Yeah.
Right. And you're like, that's it. The world must pay.
Yeah, and you're going
to
be.
It's time for me to become.
You're going to be the guy in that Russell Crowe film where he gets cut off.
Oh, yeah.
He goes and murders the family.
What's that freaking called again? Like Maniac?
Yeah.
Or something?
The best thing about it is it's like Fat Russell Crowe. Like
yeah,
it's
Fat
post.
Russell Crowe. And he's like driving a Ford F-150, which I think is supposed to like, he's supposed to symbolize like racism. I don't know. The family's white that he kills. I don't understand. I don't know what he's trying to say.
It's a single mother family, I think.
Yeah. I don't know what the gimmick is. But okay, so you get cut off in traffic and you're like, that's it. That was the last straw. You know, he would just like finished watching Taxi Driver or whatever, and you're like, these streets
the world
need to be cleaned up.
Burn,
the world must burn. There's too much evil in this world. There's too many people taking advantage of people. I gotta build traps and kill people with them.
Yeah.
Right? You just decide that.
All right, I'm there.
You put you there. Okay. Mm-hmm. What's your first move?
All right. So this is easy because this is the largest hurdle to get over to do this. Finding a space where you can do all of this stuff.
Yeah.
The real estate market is not nice. It's tough out there right now for people who are looking for abandoned warehouses in order to build saw traps.
Yeah. Right? Especially since it's such a popular thing to do right now.
I know. It feels like
a week doesn't go by without somebody just knocking over.
Yeah, after people found out that the 10th film is actually pretty good, all of a sudden everybody wants to be building traps in abandoned warehouses.
Yeah.
So it would be... the operative word here is abandoned, so like you could find disused ones and operate there, but that's like really hard to do. I think it would be better to buy it under a shell company.
Well, the thing is that most of them are owned by somebody.
Yeah.
Most places like that. Somebody owns the land. Mm-hmm. It's not like it's totally unowned.
Exactly. Exactly. So you would need to buy the land, or you need to lease it, rent it.
Yeah. Rent it.
Just imagine just like.
And then your first victim is your landlord. Yes! In life, you tried to get me to pay $250 a month for this huge ass sawmill in the middle of nowhere. Why thought that was like way more than reasonable.
The utilities must pay.
The utilities alone are insane. I mean, you're trying to warm up an entire sawmill.
Landlords are parasites. Yeah. You will pay. Okay. So,
okay.
Get the land. That'd be number one.
Yeah. I think that the best way to do it would probably be to go to either the middle of nowhere or like somewhere that's bombed out, you know, like rural Detroit. I don't even think I would go to warehouse. I think basement.
Mm-hmm. Like basement.
Especially
in a
to start
rubble?
Off.
Yeah.
You know, because a lot of people say that being a trapster is something
which
that,
is, of course, the way that is spoken of.
Yes, in the community.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. So a lot of people say
the
being a trapster,
are,
you know, this is the big show. This
you might not expect this, but the forums for trapsters, incredibly wholesome community.
Truly.
Very helpful. Yeah. We'll answer your questions. Great recommendations from these trapster folks.
Yeah. It, you know, it's just a lot of memes.
Yeah.
You know, my face when they say, I don't want to eat my own eyeballs. anyway,
my face when I put a bowl of grapes in front of them and they have to reach for a key out of it.
Yeah. that or when I eat a turd shaped chocolate. And I'm so crazy and wacky. anyway, but you don't really start making good money for a few years in the trapster world.
Yeah.
Initially, it's very, you know.
Especially because you're working off of whatever these people have in their pockets.
Exactly.
Right? Which is
exactly.
Tough.
And, you know, and later on, of course, when the deals come in and the franchising, like you make a lot of money, but initially you're not making a lot of money. So I would try not to overshoot it. It'd be basement, whatever I could do. You know, probably sort of like a barbarian, you know, where you've got like a dungeon basement in the middle of bombed out Detroit. I'd just buy like a random house somewhere on the outskirts of Hamtramck or something. Right. I would hopefully with nothing nearby, I'd build out, you know, I'd get some pre-rusted steel wall or not steel because steel doesn't rust, but pre-rusted iron walls and stuff.
And it takes a long time to distress that stuff yourself. So you're better off just buying it pre-rusted. Because
a lot of people don't remember, but the first Saw movie was just two guys in like a bathroom. And one of
them. It's true.
Yeah. One of them was whatever. What's his freaking face? The guy from Princess Bride. Cary Elwes is in the first Saw movie, which is a funny weird thing. But yeah, that you'd have to start out small is my idea. Like as far as purchasing large quantities of rusted metal, all that stuff, you can just go to junk shops, graveyards, as in car graveyards, not an actual graveyard, my bad. Car graveyards, that sort of thing. Purchase all of the materials that you need. That's not going to be crazy. That's not expensive. Now, making sure that you have like utilities and power and all that stuff.
Dude, the open copper wire that you're going to need for your electricity trap, that is incredibly expensive.
Exactly. Right? And then you're in downtown Hamtramck. You're in the outskirts of Hamtramck. The amount of crackheads you're going to have to knock away from trying to get into your basement and
steal your copper wire.
That actually is another funny thing that could happen. and they write about this sometimes. Like, say you got a guy in a trap. And it's like, in life, you charge too much people for electricity or too much money for electricity, BPU employee. And he's like, I'm just an employee. Why are you doing this? I got to start somewhere. so, you know, you have him hooked up and there's all these live wires and he's got to either, you know, say his ABC backwards while having his teeth taken out or, you know, be electrocuted to death, something like that.
Yeah. Standard trapster stuff.
Trapster stuff.
I've done a million times.
The reason why I'm speeding past it is because if you've listened to podcasts like this, and I'm sure you do if you're interested in this stuff, that you've heard this a million times. you know, so the wire is going at you, and then all of a sudden, door slams open. You're like, oh, crap. Oh, man, not again. And, you know, like three crackheads running, dismantle your whole trap and then run off. And now you got to like go in and like release the guy because he got out on a technicality. That or you got to kill him. And since you don't murder, you know.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's it. Yeah. You've automatically reduced your credibility.
What we got to do actually is you walk in and it's like, he's like, well, do I get to leave now? And you're like,
in life, you had a gun.
And you just shoot him with a gun.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
People call that the old backdoor trick, right? You know, that's the way that a lot of these trapsters get out of those kind of situations.
Yeah.
I will say there's never been a better time to get into it.
Yeah. The trapster community is, you know, you have to kind of use unconventional ways to find their corner of the internet. But once you get there, you know, a lot of really accepting, friendly people, you know, regardless of your race, religion, ethnicity, gender, identity, they accept you with open arms as long as you come up with good traps and are handy, you know.
Yeah, you got to be handy. Yeah.
You got to know how to weld.
Yeah. At the very least.
Basic electronics.
Yeah, basic electronics, physics for sure.
Yes.
You got to have
a
good understanding of physics. Access to animal carcasses. That's a tough one.
I didn't know that was a thing.
Yeah. Well, there's the saw trap where the guy is in a pool, and this is probably one of the most disgusting traps. So trigger warning.
You didn't think eating your own eyeballs was a rat with cartoon eyeballs?
Yeah, but this is just like I think it's like kind of funny, but it's guy in pool and there's a grinder.
Yeah.
That pig carcasses are getting dropped into, and the grinded pig carcass shoots out into the pool and he's slowly getting drowned by all the pig carcass stuff.
Okay.
So, you know, that's tough. Meat, expensive. Regardless of what
inflation.
Regardless of the state.
What did that guy do in life that required that to happen to him?
I think it was a greed thing. I don't remember. Well, no. It was the guy who had to try to save him, and the guy had refused to give him insurance and his wife died or something like that. You know, sometimes it's not as entirely poetic as it is.
Yeah. So here's another thing that you should be worried about when you're being a trapster. One, first off, it's funny because no one's going to care about how poetic your justice is if you're doing your job properly.
Exactly. If they're not making it out.
If you're trying to do stuff like with the American healthcare system or insurance, you know, or Wall Street, no one understands that stuff. And you probably don't either, you know? If you're sitting there being like, oh man, our healthcare system is broken. I got to kill this guy who was like making it hard to get healthcare. It's like, okay, you know, that's direct action. We can respect it. But I think that
revolutionary mindset.
Revolutionary mindset. But the thing is that revolutionary mindset requires, you know, I feel like most people would claim you have to make an example in some way. I don't know if they have a revolutionary mindset. It seemed kind of silly to be in like, it's like, and yet another big government executive for healthcare or whatever has died in a crazy ass way. It's like, what's that going to do? How's that going to change? You know?
No. The thing about Jigsaw is it's about practical life changes.
Yeah.
I'm a heroin addict. I went through the Jigsaw gauntlet. I am no longer a heroin addict.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly. Maybe we should turn this into a rehab thing. Mm. In life, you had a disease called addiction that initially you caused, but now you can't help. So now you must complete this 12-step program. This is Brad. He's your sponsor. If you ever feel like you want to do heroin, you should give him a call.
And he's tied up next to him.
Hey, yeah. And he's like, hey, man, I've been there. I've been there.
I've been in that seat.
Yeah. Now introduce yourself and tell us something really screwed up you've done for heroin.
Hi, I'm Chris. One time.
Everybody says hi, Chris, except for the guy who doesn't have a tongue anymore.
Yeah. Hi, Chris. I'm Chris. I've been addicted to heroin for 10 years. And one time I sold my dad's most prized possession in order to buy heroin.
And what was that prized possession?
Oh, it was just It was just some record.
No, it wasn't just some record.
Dad?
That's right, son.
You ungrateful bitch.
I'm getting you off heroin.
I raised you better than this.
Hey, what? You decided to go be a musician? Get addicted to drugs? When you could have been a perfectly good trapster.
Oh, goodness.
As
a trapster, you have to live a perfectly upstanding life. Because what happens if another trapster gets a hold of your bad life story?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then all of a sudden you're a trapster who's trapped.
Yes, exactly. In life, you smoked marijuana one time at a party,
yeah.
Right? Well, it's like being president. You can't have any dirt whatsoever, or you will be, struck down by the system,
In life, you once made a comment under your breath that was vaguely sexual to a coworker. You really shouldn't have done it, and you knew in the moment it was a bad move. Now you must sit in front of HR for 6 hours.
No, please.
Just like normal, like real life consequences to bad actions.
Oh, goodness gracious. Well, I think
dude, if I was a hack, I would follow up with like LA Jigsaw. And LA Jigsaw would be like, in life, you shoplifted. And that's okay. Carry on.
If I was a hack, I would say X joke.
I know.
Proceeds to say X joke.
I know, but X joke, I kind of thought, it was hacky, but I kind of liked X joke.
That was fun.
Okay.
That's fun. Goodness gracious. Well, I think we got to start towards the wrap up on this.
All right,
one.
Yeah. See,
let's go first up. What lessons did we learn here today? What are the moral of the story?
I think that my moral of my story is I don't think I would. There, I am having a hard time imagining cutting somebody's head off with a circular saw.
Mm-hmm.
But the real question should be, what is the least amount somebody has to do for you to purchase an abandoned warehouse and construct some sort of elaborate trap to teach them a life lesson?
Well, not only that. What would somebody have to do for you to construct in an abandoned warehouse a trap that put their head under a circular saw?
Yeah.
Because they would cut people's hands off in life as with a circular saw.
In life, you were a serial killer?
Well, I should just
kill you.
Kill you with this circular saw. There, we figured it out, guys.
Yeah.
We figured it all out.
Yeah, we really, really did.
All right. Shout out to our patrons, our top patrons, Joe Papalardo, Sammy Roberts, Zach and Amber Straley, and Luke Robson. We could not do this show without you guys. Thank you all for listening. Yeah. Have a good one.
Bye.
Peace. Oh, wait. If you're interested, we got the Patreon post show.
That's coming up.
Coming up.
Right after this.
Bye.